Good morning, Colorado. You're listening to the Daily Sunup. The Daily Sunup podcast is a conversation with the Colorado Sun. See our trust indicators at coloradosun.com/ethics. It's Friday, October 18th. Today, this Friday, it's time to talk music again with songwriter Kevin Simpson and G. Brown, director of the Colorado Music Experience. Before we begin, we'd like to thank our sponsor, Pinnacle Assurance, Colorado's leading provider of workers' compensation insurance. Pinnacle provides caring protection that Colorado businesses can rely on as they expand across the country. From finance to robotics and Arizona to Orlando, Pinnacle's nationwide coverage goes wherever Colorado businesses grow. Now, let's go back in time with some Colorado history. Colorado's beer scene is shaped by historic brands like Coors and a growing number of microbreweries. The Wincoop Brewing Company, founded by John Hickenlooper and partners on this day in 1988, launched Denver's craft beer revolution. Using severance pay, they renovated a low-dough warehouse, sparking a revival. Their success attracted more brew pubs and businesses, leading to low-dough's economic renaissance. Hickenlooper went on to become Denver's mayor, Colorado's governor, and now serves as a U.S. senator. Before we continue, AARP Colorado empowers older people to choose how they live as they age. From making Colorado communities more livable and age-friendly to supporting family caregivers, AARP Colorado is a wise friend and a fierce defender. Visit aarp.org/co for more info. Next, our feature story.
Josie's on a vacation far away. Come around and talk it over. So many things that I want to say. You know I like my girls a little bit older. I just want to use your love tonight.
Hey there, Colorado. Thanks for joining me and our good friend G. Brown, who you know as the force behind colomusic.org, which every music fan should have bookmarked on their phone or computer or whatever their device of favor is. How's it going, G?
Well, it's going, Kevin. It's not yet gone. It's still going.
Wait, just a short bit to start off this month's podcast. Anyone who recognized that clip of intro music that we played and has spent any time watching the Rockies at Coors Field over the last decade or so has probably chimed in on the lyrics. It's not a Colorado song. It's not a Colorado band. But somehow it has become full-fledged Colorado. And gee, I'm not so sure if we'll ever hear it played at Coors Field again.
I don't think so, Kevin. As we bid adieu to Charlie Blackman, the beloved outfielder who's retired after his iconic 14-year career with our Colorado Rockies, it also marked the end of an era tied to his walk-up song, which is Your Love by The Outfield. We just heard it. Just saying that that band, they were from Britain. They had some other great hits in the 80s. My favorites are Say It Isn't So, Voices of Babylon, For You, and there's many more. It's even more salient to acknowledge these guys because the two primary members of the band have left us in recent years, guitarist John Spinks and the bassist and vocalist Tony Lewis, both died within the last decade. So the music lives on, as we're fond of saying. So yeah. I just thought it was important to let people know that backstory of Your Love.
Absolutely. I love the whole concept of the walk-up song. And I got to say, my wife, who taught in the elementary school, actually allowed her kids to create walk-up songs. So when they went to the front of the class to deliver a book report or whatever, they could play a walk-up song. And they totally got off on that. I think it's a great concept. So, gee, which of the Outfield's other hits that you mentioned should we tip our caps to?
Well, let's go with the one that got my attention in the first place back in the 80s. The first notes of the very first Outfield album, Say It Isn't So.
Say it isn't so. Tell me I'm the only one. Say it isn't so. Found you, I can't go.
Well, gee, shortly after we recorded last month's podcast, we learned of the passing of J.D. Souther, whose work was ubiquitous, partly from his own performances, but largely because other stars were singing his songs. He had something of a Colorado connection, having recorded an album here, and he loved horse packing in the Ragged's Wilderness area near Gunnison. But he honed his songwriting at the famous Troubadour in Los Angeles, where he hung out with a real who's who of music superstars.
Yeah, that was ground zero for some of the biggest pop names of the Southern California country rock sound back in the 70s, and J.D. was connected with him. His writing provided material for the Eagles, most notoriously. He collaborated on Best of My Love, James Dean, New Kid in Town, Heartache Tonight, maybe most famously, and Linda Ronstadt, who J.D. dated in the 70s. Her Heart Like a Wheel album, the classic, featured his song Faithless Love. J.D. also formed the Souther Hillman Furay Band with Chris Hillman, the former Birds member, and Poco's Richie Furay, and released a series of critically acclaimed solo albums. His biggest hit was You're Only Lonely from 1979. If you're interested, you should check out COME's Gallery of Archival Recordings. You can hear J.D.'s performance of Faithless Love that he recorded at Denver's Ebbets Field back in July of 1976. That's at colomusic.org.
Fantastic. Well, could I make a request for our next clip? I love the song he co-wrote and performed with James Taylor, Her Town 2. The harmony is just magic. You know, gee, we've talked about Charlie Verrell multiple times before and the big impact that he had on music and culture as the first person of color to sign a contract with a symphony orchestra. And here we are more than half a century later, both Charlie and his imprint on the local music scene live on. Tell us about a couple of events you had a chance to attend recently.
Yeah, I'm a privileged fellow sometimes. Charlie Verrell signed with the Denver Symphony Orchestra back in 1949, and he was known then as the Jackie Robinson of classical music, as you say, breaking the color barrier in that world. Recently, there was a ribbon-cutting ceremony for the new wing of the Charles Verrell Visual and Performing Arts Campus. That's at Aurora Central High School, and they've got a freshly painted mural of Charlie on the walls there. So that's fantastic. And Charlie also just turned 104 years old earlier this month. Yeah. Dazzle Jazz Club observed the occasion with a performance by Pernell Steen and the Five Points Ambassadors, another wonderful part of our community. So Charlie showed up at both events, and it's always just so wonderful to see him.
Well, it only seems right to honor him with a clip here. What should we play?
Well, we talked about his impact in the classical music world, but one of the cooler things is that when he wasn't playing with a symphony, he took off his tuxedo and put on his peg pants and went down to Five Points and played with all of the jazz greats of the 40s and 50s. You go to colormusic.org. Again, we've got a mini documentary and a podcast and a profile that just details him playing with everyone from Billie Holiday to Duke Ellington. Really wild. Anyway, here's just a taste of Charlie's work on the double bass from back in his heyday.
Well, I love the topic of this next segment, G, as it touches on three of my favorite things, music, science, and history. And it all came together recently at, of all places, a senior living community up in Boulder. Tell us about the Wood Brothers and the man whose memory the group recently celebrated.
It's my pleasure, Kevin. I'm a fan and advocate of the Wood Brothers. They've gained international recognition for several stunning albums. They're a must-see live act. Two siblings, Chris and Oliver Wood, grow up in Boulder, and I went to this celebration in memory of their father, Bill Wood, at Fraser, the Boulder senior living community. Turns out Bill was a pioneering scientist. He transformed the University of Colorado Boulder into a nationally ranked hub of biomedical science. But he also loved music in equal measure. And that meaningful family connection is what I really honed in on. Bill in high school played in a group with John Hartford, that revered banjo musician who went on to mentor a generation of newgrass players, if you will. And then while an undergraduate chemistry major in Harvard back in the late 50s, he also played guitar in a group called the Ranch Hands and hosted a weekly program on the campus radio station. And that's where he met a lady named Joan Baez.
I've heard of her.
18 years old then in her first year of college. And in 1959, Bill Wood and another gentleman, Ted Elavizos, teamed with the future folk legend, her Nibs, to make a record that's now renowned as her historic first recording. It's called Folk Singers Round Harvard Square. And then a year later, Joan Baez produced her first solo album, and Bill Wood opted for a career in science. There was an interview that he conducted at Stanford about a decade ago. He reflected on that early fork in the road. He said it was really clear which one of them should go to grad school at Stanford and which one of them should go to the Newport Folk Festival. he described it, with all due respect to his fellow scientists, as the most fun he ever had, singing with Joan Baez. So you tie it together, family, science, and history, but we, again, leading with family, the tie-in here, early in Chris and Oliver Wood's childhood in Boulder, they got exposed to music through Bill, who sang and played songs at campfires, family gatherings, ad hoc events. And what was really cool is to see how Bill's passion also continued to inspire them. In his final years, he was the driving force in developing the Fraser Music Studio Project, which houses the instrument collection of two other Colorado music stalwarts, Bonnie Carroll and Max Krimmel, who are fellow residents. And it also provides programs for the Fraser community to jam or learn new instruments. So you see how music affects people, especially at that stage in life. Just fantastic. And the brothers paid an informal visit to Fraser a few years ago to perform with their dad and help raise funds for the construction of the studio. So just a very heartwarming story, and it's great to celebrate Bill's legacy as well as his boys.
Well, I understand music fans can learn more from a conversation you had with Chris Wood. G, can you give us a little preview of that and tell folks where they can find it?
Yeah, we sat down and chatted, Chris and I. He detailed parts of his father's sway and legacy and his podcast for Colorado Music Experience. We did it 4 years ago, but you can find it at our website, colomusic.org, colomusic.org.
So what should we play from the Wood Brothers?
Oh, how about just one of my favorites? But we can dedicate it to the family, Luckiest Man.
Yeah, they say running is useless, fighting is foolish. You're not gonna win, but still you're the luckiest man. You're up against too many horses and mysterious forces. What's it done always? You are the luckiest man.
Well, gee, our time is about up, And thanks for joining us to talk music. And thanks to our listeners for tuning in. How about another J.D. Souther song to play us into the weekend?
Okay. Radio rule number one, much to my chagrin sometimes, but play the hits. In J.D.'s case, that would be You're Only Lonely.
All right, here we go. See you next time, G.
Yes, sir.
Read more at coloradosun.com. Finally, here are a few stories that you should know about today. The Colorado mine, where a tour guide was killed and others were stranded for hours underground, is under a cease and desist order. It was sent this week to the owners of the former gold mine turned tourist attraction. Officials are investigating why the elevator in the 1,000-foot mine shaft malfunctioned. Health insurance prices in Colorado will increase again next year, but by a below-average amount. According to approved rates released Thursday, rates in the individual market are going up by 5.6% on average. That is below the average annual increase of the past decade, which is 6.9%. A federal judge has ruled that Denver's Gross Reservoir expansion violates the Clean Water Act. The judge did not order Denver Water to stop construction in Boulder County, but she said the environmental plaintiffs have a right to relief from any damage that will occur to surrounding land and forest. For more information on all of these stories, visit our website, coloradosun.com. And don't forget to tune in again next time. Now, a quick message from our team.
This is Michael Booth.
And this is John Ingold. We cover health and climate here at the Colorado Sun.
Every week, John and I work together to send out a newsletter to our premium members called The Temperature.
In this newsletter, we share our latest reporting about health and climate and how they intersect. Issues like forever chemicals, healthcare's rising costs, and the lingering effects of the pandemic. The Temperature is one of our weekly newsletters available to members at the premium level.
To sign up, head to coloradosun.com/join. Not only will you be able to sign up for The Temperature and our other premium newsletters, but you'll be supporting the Colorado Sun as a member, and thanks for doing that.